So we need these little toys here, like this. Is there a toy we didn't use, we said we would use? I like that. Yeah, you can do that. You can do that.
No.
Okay.
Okay. On top.
Hi. Welcome to the second in the series of Unboxing the Inanimatti. I'm Chris. This is Fiorella.
Hello.
And we're here actually in COVID conditions, but because we want to be in the same studio together, we've put a plexiglass shield between us. I didn't expect that. Okay, that way we can talk a little bit more normally and still have a good COVID condition here. In the first film, we mentioned some of the basic principles, ground rules for making your own Inanimatti. And among those was that it is not about a superpower, superhero universe.
And it's not a magical fantasy one, neither.
And even though in the reality that we're talking about, people were with the Inanimatti at one time, where they are now, there are no people. So no humans in this story. Animals, yes, but no humans.
And no anthropomorphic features and add-ons like hands, feet, clothes, nothing.
So, you know, just saying that, I'm sure some people last time wondered, so if they don't have these hands and feet like are used to be putting in cartoons about things that are alive, so how do they hold things?
They cooperate.
They cooperate. That's kind of one of the basic premises behind the Inanimatti, to promote the idea that purposes were meant to be shared. And so by sharing a purpose, an object which is more complex can come together of its parts. Like, for instance, this pliers here. This pliers here is made of a number of different parts, all smaller than her pliers. But anyway, if the parts don't decide to work together to be a pliers, it can't work. So it's about sharing a purpose. This is one of the key things. In that first episode, we concluded by saying, let's look next time at how Professor Penn, who you saw in the Shira film, came from a feather. And you know, that way you can see how an Inanimatti is actually made. So a pen, Professor Penn, from a feather. Now that's kind of an interesting concept. You know, you want to tell us something about that?
Yes. He is our kids' teacher, very serious, very knowledgeable. But actually, you know, outside class, he hides a secret. His past may come back to remind him of his roots.
We're not going
to
tell anybody what the secret
okay.
is. Okay. Anyway, but what we wanted to talk about is how Professor Penn came from a feather, right?
Exactly.
I tell you what, let me see the pen, please.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Now, this is very interesting because the pens, if you get into the idea of a character through the objectomy lens, you try to understand it as it really is, what it thinks about. And normally you would think a pen is thinking about writing. But when you study it a bit more, you realize there's two conditions. There's the pen open and there's the pen in a closed condition. So all pens have a sort of a secret identity when they're closed. Like, what are they really thinking about?
Yes, and this way of imagining is what we call objectomy. The description of a character has to be a natural flow, not a forced process, and it has to match the object itself. We can say that an object has to express itself, you know, it has to speak, and we just have to listen carefully to what it wants to say to us, what it wants to share. The feathers in the Athenaeum, where Professor Penn comes from, they actually come from a proto-animal called the CroApe, an animal which is half crow and half great ape.
Crow apes, also called crapes, right?
Yes.
And, but you're going to tell me the name of the queen of the crepes?
Suzette? I told you, he likes puns.
That was a really bad one. Okay, so anyway, so the crow apes give up their feathers to the Athenaeum to become quills. But how does a queen become a pen? Yeah, that's the key thing.
Professor Penn was once running an entire room of quill pens, scribes, who were writing down the chapters of the Fabula Rerum as long as the story unfolds. And in order to gain his position, he had to start as a quill pen. So this is to say he was once a feather.
So we start with Professor Penn as a pen, but he didn't start as a pen. He started out as a quill feather, right?
Yes.
Okay, so how does one become the other?
Because natural elements in our story aren't alive. And in order to become Inanimatti, they have to be together with a small thing, a small object. They bring them to this new life of the Inanimatti.
Okay, so, and in this case, what was it?
And in this case, Professor Penn started from a feather together with a small metal ring that we can say drives him to write and become a quill pen.
And this is kind of interesting. Even today, here's a little close-up of my wife's pen. You can see the metal ring in the middle of it carries a bunch of engraved words. And the words are actually, the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog, which is uses all the letters of the English alphabet, and it's what writers use to, you know, inspire themselves about writing. So we even imagine today that a small part of something as complicated as a pen is still got the spirit of it embedded in it. So it's not so far away from Professor Penn starting life as a metal ring around a feather.
And along the story, his penness, if we can say that.
His penness.
His penness.
Can you say penness?
His penness. His penness.
Yes, your penness.
And the feather got naturally embedded into his own structure.
That's an example of an organic element becoming alive, let's say, when it hooks up with a piece of an inanimati, a little metal ring. There's another example in Shear, which is very interesting, and that is Rocky, the rock hammer, who is a stone, basically, and put together with a stick.
That hammer and hammer, the tough ballot mallet, the stony punisher himself, Rocky Four!
So what's the element that put them together? Because a stick is also a natural element.
They're held together through a belt.
It's that belt, that strap that's kind of around the whole thing. That's the key to the whole thing.
It makes them alive. And they share the same purpose, we can say.
And of course, this is a whole exercise in inventing characters. Professor Penn, Rocky, we're talking about how characters are made. And as you get into the characters, you have to start looking at their backstory, inventing those backstories. And that leads you to invent new characters to fill in the spots that are opening up. Speaking of which, spots. That's two characters I really, really like are the little flashlights, Blinkit and Spot.
Two little flashlights, two brothers. Spot, the tallest and older, and Blinkit, the youngest.
Now, when you say they're brothers, I thought, you know, inanimati don't have, like, reproduction like we do.
Exactly. They don't reproduce as humans do, but they have some genealogy, like, I mess it up! Some genealogy. Human genealogy. But we can still use some genealogy names such as cousin.
We're both so amazed. Like, fuck, she said it right.
Inanimati don't have fathers and mothers, but we can still use some genealogy names such as cousins and aunt. And, you know, sometimes when two inanimati share same characteristics, such as the two flashlights, we can call them brothers or sisters.
Even though they're a little bit different in age.
Yes, and in size also.
Well, you know, speaking of age, you know, what is this process of aging? You know, as they go through their purposes, is it just a question of time?
Inanimati, they don't age like we do. We talked about reality being split into three, and so was the flow of time. So these animati, they can grow, but it doesn't really mean that they necessarily become adults. They don't go by years, but they go by purpose steps.
You mean like each step of a new purpose in their life, a new objective, they have to change to match it?
Yes, they go through a change, but it doesn't really mean that they become instantly adults. We can say that they mature, but it may take more than one step, just like humans. Some mature earlier than others.
Well, in the case of the inanimati, these steps might involve them just getting bigger, like Arki, or it might involve them coming together with other inanimati to form a really complex new one. And it might also be something like where a number of inanimati have to get together then, you know, more complex ones, and make an even more complex one. And that's, of course, the whole idea behind the story is to see how the characters progress along this path.
And the more parts, the more you can deep dive into the backstory of it.
And the parts somehow relate to one another when they get more complicated. Beater, the egg beater, he becomes a lawnmower in the next step of his purpose. You know, they share blades and things like that, so they're kind of similar. But he gains, you know, some gears and some wheels and a few things like that. So for him, you know, it's an upgrade. So Blinkit and Spot are obviously at the beginning of their set of purpose steps. But already, they brought up a number of questions just looking at them as characters. Like, you know, do they have batteries?
Does electricity exist in the Inanimatti world?
You know, do they have other characteristics as Inanimatti that are unusual?
Well, Blinkit has allergy.
Flashlights with allergies. This is really what we need. Okay, good. Flashlight with allergy. Okay, we showed you a number of rules, guidelines, principles today to make your own Inanimatti. Have fun with them. You know, it keeps the whole thing kind of glued together and you discover all kinds of new things. And maybe, you know, in the future, we're going to go to the Athenaeum. This is where Professor Penn does his work, and we can show you the artists that are working on it, talk to them. You get an idea what's going on behind the scenes with that.
We would have lots of questions for our viewers, but probably the most important one is, what object would you like to see transformed into an Inanimatti? You know, let us know. Challenge us.
Now, that will be a challenge. Don't do a pen, though. I think we're on a pen already, yeah?
Hammers.
Yeah, okay, we're kind of already there with those. And scissors, I think we got a scissors too.
Scissors, definitely.
Yeah, okay, but you'll come up with something else too. Let us know. So until next time on Unboxing the Inanimatti.
Ciao, ciao. Ciao. Ciao.